Okay, so let's discuss the bony features of the spine, the ribs, and the sternum. So the lumbar vertebra, so the lower five vertebra, have general features of all vertebra. They're kind of the nondescript vertebra. And so every vertebra has its vertebral body, seen here in red. Then this whole posterior element is called the vertebral arch or the neural arch. And it's because, if I had this turned upside down, the spinal cord goes through this foramen, and these features create an arch or a bridge over the spinal column. We have the vertebral foramen, which is the hole for your spinal or your spinal cord. You have the pedicle, which connects the vertebral body to the transverse processes. You have the lamina, which connect the transverse processes to the spinal or the spinous process, and then you have the spinous process, and finally your transverse processes. So you can imagine three processes, and then these little pieces of bones that kind of connect to make this archway for that goes over the vertebral foramen. So let's look, and we also have articular processes, superior and inferior. Our spine is almost like a Legos, right? They click together through the facet joints, and those can mainly be seen through a sagittal plane view. So let's look at sagittal plane view. So here we have vertebral body. Here's your neural arch, vertebral body. So we have two vertebral bodies together. That's when you can see the intervertebral foramen. Foramen means hole, inter, between two vertebra. And then you can see your superior process and your inferior process. So basically the inferior process of the superior vertebra connects with the superior process of the inferior vertebra. And you should really look at a skeleton to kind of get that straight in your mind. All right, so let's look at the cervical vertebra. They're smaller. Vertebral bodies are much smaller. They have a bifid tip on their spinous process. So here's their spinous process. They have these two tips. They also have costal processes and transverse foramen. And so these are for blood vessels to go through. So it's not the intervertebral foramen, and these are on individual vertebra, holes bilateral to the vertebral body. Then we have two special cervical vertebra, the atlas, which is holding up the world, right, holds up the head, and the axis. So you can imagine the atlas is responsible for nodding yes and no, nodding, flexion, extension. The axis is responsible for no, right and left rotation. So we have, and this is anterior and posterior, as it says, you have your vertebral arch, anterior and posterior. You have the anterior and posterior tubercles. You have your articular facets, just like your processes, but they don't stick up quite as much. And then we have the axis, and it has the odontoid process, or the dens. And if you look from a sagittal view, it's sticking up. It's very obvious. It looks like a little pivot point. And then your transverse ligament, which basically this atlas sits over this axis, and this transverse ligament kind of holds the odontoid process within this little space up here. Okay. Thoracic vertebra. We'll look at those in sagittal view. So you have your superior and inferior demi-facets. Very small little indentation, superior on the vertebral body and inferior on the vertebral body. You also have your transverse costal facets on both transverse processes. And these, anytime it says costal, it means ribs. So the ribs come here, come back and engage with the thoracic vertebra on the transverse process as well. And again, you need to really look at a skeleton, a full skeleton, to see this interaction. And then how you can really tell if a vertebra is a thoracic rather than a cervical and a lumbar is this really long angled spinous process. We also have our sacrum. So here's an anterior view, here's a posterior view. So you can see the vertebral bodies. It is fused, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There is the apex, which is the point, if you will. It's kind of triangular shape. There is the base, which is the top of the triangle. You have your articular processes where L5 engages, right? L5S1. You have the sacral canal, which is where the neural spinal cord continues down to bifurcate and go off to the lower limbs. You have your median sacral crest, so that's midline. So those are basically your spinous processes of the sacrum. Your lateral sacral crests, so those are the old transverse processes of these fused vertebrae. You can feel that, three bumps on the posterior side of the sacrum. And then you have your sacral foramina. And you can see there's all these holes, whoop, sorry, down the sacrum. And that is where nerve roots will leave the sacrum. All right, final bones, the ribs and the sternum. So this is anterior view. You can always tell anterior view because you see the sternum. Posterior view because you see the scapula and the spinous processes or the posterior part of the vertebra. You have true ribs, 7 pair, and they directly connect to the sternum. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So these are directly connected to the sternum. You have, and those are vertebrosternal ribs from the vertebra to the sternum. Vertebrobronchial are false ribs, and there's 3 pair. And so they have one common connection. So you can see this is one common connection to the sternum, and it branches out to these lower false ribs. And then finally, we have our floating ribs, and you can see those mainly posteriorly. They don't connect to the sternum via a common connection, via anything. They are truly floating. And so those are the ones that can puncture internal organs and things like that. So sometimes they can get broken. So sometimes you have to be careful of those, and those are protecting the kidney. But they have no connection to the sternum. And then finally, let's look at the sternum. 3 sections. You have your manubrium, right? The superiormost portion of the sternum. You have your sternal or jugular notch, which is the actual tippy top of the manubrium. You have the body of the sternum. And then the xiphoid process. And again, if you do CPR incorrectly, pushing, you can sometimes break off this xiphoid process and it can puncture the lungs.